Thank you for those of you who are able to participate in communion today. We're thankful for those opportunities to not only tie us to our Christian past, but press us forward into our Christian future. The best days of Christendom are ahead of us. Do you believe that? At the 9 o'clock, I believed it a little more than you did. Do you believe that? Jesus promises it to us. Look, there's been a lot of victory this week. You know, we had the Flyers win their opener this week. That's what I'm talking about. It was you know what the best part about it was? Is I was sitting next to PB at the game as he watched his Devils. He tells me that he's at the art show this weekend, enjoying a weekend, you know, with Miss Cheryl in Lancaster. I just really didn't think he wanted to face the Flyers fans this morning. No, be praying for him. He's enjoying some time well-deserved away as he's in Lancaster this afternoon, enjoying some time with Miss Cheryl. But we also had some other victories this week. I mean, the Phillies are in the NLCS. That's what I'm talking about. And the Eagles still remain and will remain the only undefeated team in football. And we know that God references Eagles in the Bible and does not reference Cowboys. We understand that. And also, once again, as I will continue every week, you are welcome for Lisa and I coming back. It is no coincidence that these streaks started as God brought us back to this place. It really isn't. It really isn't. There's a lot of victory happening around. Some organizational victory and news as well. Organizationally, we got a Candy Palooza and a Trunk or Treat coming up in two Sundays. But here's the thing. Guys, we only have, now as of last service, now we have 8 cars for Trunk or Treat. Now look, Chick-fil-A, God's chicken, is on the line. Like, the winning car gets a $50 Chick-fil-A basket. And God's chicken must be eaten. And there's only 8 in the competition right now. So you gotta see Johnny K in the back and get all signed up. Donate your candy. And in all reality, what we wanna do is, I want you to have bragging rights for the year. But more importantly, there's a lost and dying world out there that'll come and bring their kids in costume to get candy. And we want to share Jesus with them. We want to share the love of God with them. And just like the Apostle Paul becomes all things to all men, we wear costumes and give out candy so that we can win people to Jesus. So make sure you do that. Sign up. Volunteer. Heather needs volunteers to teach these kids about Jesus. So do all of that. And then some other big organizational news. We are bringing on a creative arts pastor. So we are really excited. And do not worry, Chad is working with them. Chad is part of the family. He's done an incredible job. Can we give a round? Honor where honor's due. Hasn't he done a great job in doing those things? He's done an incredible job, and he's going to continue to partner with them and press our ministry forward in all that they're doing. They're here observing today. They should be in the front row here. You'll see him. You can't miss him. He'll be the tallest guy here, and his wife might be the shortest one here. And it'll be great. Their names are Michael and Abby. Please be sure to meet them. You'll love them the way I do, and you'll get to see them lead worship next week together, I believe, with Chad, so it'll be great. It'll be great. So that's what's happening. We're all about victory right now. And we're going to teach a sermon today about victory. Now, you may not be like me. There may be some very sad, pathetic, sinful people in the room called Cowboys fans. And they may not remember pieces of victory because it was so, so, so long ago. But if you're like me and are holy and love the Lord and pull for Philadelphia sports, your favorite moment of victory may be one of mine. Go ahead and play the clip.
Brady under pressure, escapes the sack, launching one for the end zone.
Thank you.
I mean, we wouldn't even have to have church today. We could just play that on loop over and over and over again. God would be glorified in moments like that. But in order to get moments like that, moments of victory, we have to eliminate stoppers of momentum. We're in week two of our sermon series called Momentum, Building on the Past and Pressing Toward the Future. And you don't get to moments of victory like that. You don't get to moments of victory in your life. And as a Christian, we don't experience spiritual moments of victory unless we eliminate stoppers of momentum. And the largest stopper of momentum in a Christian's life is sin. So last week we did a whole sermon called Legacy Lever. This week, we're going to talk about how to be a sin stopper. How to be a sin stopper. The largest stopper of momentum for the Christian is sin, so we must be sin stoppers in order to claim the victory that God has for us. We're going to continue in Joshua today and take away two truths on how to be a sin stopper in order to claim victory. Number one, make it right. Make it right. Joshua 7, and we're going to read 12 verses in Joshua. So follow along. If you have an app, go ahead and open your YouVersion Bible app. Follow along. If you have a physical Bible, open your Bible to Joshua 7. If you don't have a Bible, let me help you download a Bible, or I will give you a Bible. Just see me after service, and we'll get you taken care of. And this is what the Bible has to say about making it right and how to be a sin stopper. Joshua 7, 1 through 12. But the people of Israel broke faith in regard to devoted things. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took some of the devoted things. And the anger of the Lord burned against the people of Israel. Joshua sent men from Jericho to Ai, which is near Bethaven, east of Bethel, and said to them, go up and spy out the land. And the men went up and spied out Ai. And they returned to Joshua and said to him, do not have all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and attack Ai. Don't make the whole people toil up there, for they are few. So about 3,000 men went up from the people, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai killed 36 of the men and chased them before the gate as far as Sherbaim and struck them at the descent. And the hearts of the people melted and became as water. Then Joshua tore his clothes and fell on the earth on his face before the ark of the Lord until the evening, he and the elders of Israel. And they put dust on their heads. And Joshua said, alas, O Lord God, why have you brought this people over the Jordan at all? To give us into the hand of the Amorites? To destroy us? Would that we had been content to dwell beyond the Jordan. O Lord, what can I say when Israel has turned their back before their enemies? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear of it and will surround us and cut us off our name from the earth. And what will you do for your great name? Then the Lord said to Joshua, get up. Why have you fallen on your face? Israel have sinned. They've transgressed my covenant that I commanded them. They have taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen and lied and put them among their own belongings. Therefore, the people of Israel cannot stand before their enemies. They turn their backs before their enemies because they have become devoted for destruction. I will be with you no more unless you destroy the devoted things from among you. So let's give some context to what's taking place here. Let's tell the story a little bit. Last week, we talked about how Joshua went over the Jordan. His first unexpected challenge is faced with immediately. So he leads the people over the Jordan River, and they step through. They build the monument. They claim their miracle. There's building all of this momentum. Then Joshua prays to God again. Again, there's a theme here. He relies on the Lord. The Lord begins to bless. So he prays to God again, and he says, God, now there's this big city with a lot of walls called Jericho. They're really well armed, and to be honest with you, we're not really prepared. So they give all of their reliance upon God. Joshua asks God what to do. He gives very clear vision to the Israelites. They do this like crazy CrossFit exercise all the way around Jericho, like a lot of times, right? And then Jericho falls, and they win this big battle, and now they begin to kind of feel themselves. So they've upset the big city. They walked across the river on dry land. And then they see this little city in the distance. And Joshua goes, go ahead, check it out. Come back, give me the report. And the guys come up to Joshua and they go, send about 2,000 or 3,000. We don't need everybody to go up. Like, don't waste their time. Never consulting God. Never prayerfully seeking his face. It's not the same leadership that looks at the Jordan and says, God, please help. It's not the same leadership that walks up to Jericho and says, God, what do we do? They rely on their own inhibitions and they fail. They don't seek God. And God tells them some reasons why they fail. The reason the nation lost this battle, this easy battle, is because God knew this guy Achan had grabbed some forbidden items when they fought Jericho. Because of this, God punished the nation. You ever heard the expression like sin in the camp? This is where it comes from. The exact biblical phrase, sin in the camp. This is exactly where it comes from. What had happened is that God withheld his blessing from his people because of one man's hidden sin. Achan thought he could get away with it, but the all-seeing God saw it. And because he is just and always does what is right, there were tragic consequences. You see, what tripped Achan up is no different than what trips us up today. Achan said that it started with seeing what he knew he shouldn't have. Then he coveted, then he took. Sin is all around us. It's not whether we're going to see it, it's when we're going to see it. And as Achan, he knew there was going to be temptation as they plundered Jericho. And isn't it just like the enemy to throw temptation in right after a large blessing? You know, oftentimes we feel like the enemy attacks us in the shadow of the valley of death. But oftentimes it's when the enemy attacks us in green pastures when we're surprised. And you know, what happens is they have this great victory and Achan sees all this spoil and he's probably in a place where you and I have been before and he's like, God, this is amazing. And are you sure I can't have just a little bit more? Like, just a little bit of the forbidden. It pulls us all the way back to original sin, right? This is literally what happens to Adam and Eve. God, this is an amazing garden. Like, I just can't get one bite of that, though. That looks great. And what ruined it for Achan is what ruins it for us. It's when we look, stare, and then it controls our thinking, our desires to where we must have it. That's coveting in a nutshell. The next natural action for us is the same as Achan's, to take. Take it for ourselves when we know good and well we shouldn't have anything to do with it. What have you coveted and taken after? For Achan, the sad part is his sin did not only affect him, it ended with his family being burned and stoned. It ended with the Israelites losing 36 men and his family being deeply affected. Why such a cruel punishment is all because of sin. Please understand, church, that your sin doesn't only impact you, it impacts those around you and those you care about. The chances are that all of Israel did not know that Achan had taken a forbidden item, but his sin still affected and infected all of Israel. So I ask you, are you like Achan? Are you putting up like a blessing blocker today? Whether anyone knows it or not, rest assured that God knows, and that's all that matters. God knows. You know what Achan thought is he thought that his sin only affected him. He thought that his sin was only influential in his life. He thought that his sin would only affect himself, and maybe it would affect his family, but he didn't realize that his sin would affect his whole nation. And church, what we need to realize is that God's posture towards us is yes and amen. God's posture towards us is blessing. God's posture towards us is yes. I know there's probably some in the room that grew up with a God that you feared was waiting for you to mess up so he could strike you down. But that's not God's posture towards you. God's posture towards you is blessing. And what happens is when sin comes into our life, it's like taking an umbrella and putting up a blessing blocker. Okay, so now we're walking here and God's showering blessing. Oh, there's a financial blessing. It blocked off of my sin. Oh, there's a physical blessing. Oh, the sin blocker is up. Oh, there's a physical blessing. Oh, I can't get to that. And you see, we put up these blessing blockers called sin. And what Achan did with his sin is sometimes what we can do with our sin. And we're blessing blocking our whole family, our church, our nation. And rest assured, what you think is private, God knows, and that's the one that matters. We've placed a blessing blocker in our life. We must eliminate sin. We must make it right with God. Look, the point is we must make it right, but that also you can find forgiveness and restoration in Christ today. How can God forgive you? Remember when Jesus died on the cross? It was he that took your sin and shame and put it on himself. Christ would then do the incredible. This is the most beautiful part of the gospel. He would then take his righteousness and place it on you. Now when God looks at you, he sees the righteousness of his son instead of your sin. Look, I'm not eliminating the natural consequences that result from sin, but I'm saying don't let it be consequences that come from God because you refuse to get it right with him. The Lord is not done with you yet, and the Lord was not done with Israel. And once the nation made it right, they were able to move to victory, and you can do the same today. Number two, the way to be a sin stopper is to move to victory. And think about this. So this is where Joshua finds himself. He finds himself in a frustrated place with the elders of Israel. They're putting ash on their head. They're frustrated at the loss. They're seeking God's help. I mean, imagine Joshua in this posture, right? Just a few weeks or months before, he sat there and he sat back and he looked at the Ark of the Covenant and the priests walking towards the Jordan River. And imagine that reliance that he had on God as Joshua's sitting there, he's saying, man, I hope when those feet touch the water that it splits, because God, I'm gonna look really dumb if this doesn't happen. The priests are just gonna get their shoes wet. Imagine the reliance he had on God when he gave the instruction to Israel to walk around Jericho those multiple times. And he's thinking, I hope I didn't just give people a really good exercise session. Like, God, please let it come through. Like, all of these massive faith things, and then there's this little thing, right? There's this little city. And Joshua goes, I don't really need to rely on God for that. Like, it's just 2,000 or 3,000. We'll just send them. And he lost. You know, I fear we come from massive victories and then we move into moments of self-reliance. Because somewhere in our convolution, we believe that it was us who did it and not the victor Christ who did it through us. And we take all of these massive miracles that God has done and we put them on display, and somehow we think, but God, I got the little one. When we don't. And look at what God does. His posture towards Joshua again is a yes and amen with beautiful grace as Joshua finds himself in this tumultuous place. This is what Joshua said, or this is what God says to Joshua, Joshua 8:1-2. And the Lord said to Joshua, encourages him, do not fear and do not be dismayed. Take all the fighting men with you and arise, go up to Ai. See, I have given into your hand the king of Ai and his people and his city and his land, and you shall do to Ai, reminding him of what God did once again to Jericho and its king. Only its spoil and its livestock shall you take as plunder for yourself. Lay ambush against the city behind it. 8:18, God continues to encourage Joshua and says, stretch out the javelin that is in your hand toward Ai, for I will give it into your hand. And Joshua reaches out the javelin that was in his hand towards the city. You know, my fear in teaching what not to do is that we focus on teaching or on putting our list together of what not to do rather than what to do. Our hearts break because we lost to Ai, but we never go back into the battle. We stay in a spirit of condemnation, a spirit of guilt and shame that God has released us from. Romans 8 tells us there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ. But sometimes when we find ourselves losing these small battles, these Ai battles in our lives, we just stay in that guilt and shame and we never move forward to victory and we never claim the victory that Christ has given us. It's like the fired pizza delivery driver. I am so glad I am back in a place with good pizza. Canaan was the land flowing with milk and honey. Jersey is the land flowing with mozz and tomato sauce. And it is so good to be home with good pizza. And it's not really part of the sermon. I just wanted to say it. But the pizza delivery driver is. And the pizza delivery driver walks in to his boss's office one day, and the boss looks at him, and he says, man, I'm going to have to let you go. You're fired. And the delivery driver looks at him and says, boss, but I never got a ticket. Like, I was never late. I never sped. I never spit in anyone's food. I never did any of these things. And he looked at him, and he said, but you didn't deliver pizza. I fear as Christians, sometimes we look at God after we lose an Ai battle. And we go, yeah, but God, I didn't do this. And I didn't do that. And I didn't do this thing that I've been told my whole life I shouldn't do. And we don't focus on what we should be doing for God. Rather, we focus on the list of what we don't do. We never activate our faith to do for God. You see, we stay in the broken and contrite heart, and we never move from broken to building. We stay in this brokenness, this season of condemnation, and we look, and we're like the pizza delivery driver that lists all the things we didn't do, and then God says, but you never rebuilt. You never delivered the pizzas. Joshua, broken over this sin, goes to God, seeks his face, and admits his sin, and forgives his sin, gets rid of those coveted items, and then moves forward into victory. Christian, some of you are sitting in the place to where you're just broken about your sin, and that's a great place to be for a season, but if you stay in it too long, you are inflicting self-condemnation that Jesus never intended for your life. And he wants you to move to victory in this season, just like the Israelites did. Being a sin stopper does not stop at making it right. It requires us to move forward. The Israelites did not stop at making it right. They moved forward and did what God told them to do. Too many times we just stop in repentance, stop in making it right, and never move to victory. But the Bible tells us we're more than conquerors. Let's be just that. You know, as Christians, sometimes we feel as if we can't move to victory. We feel as if we're stuck in and of ourselves. We feel as if sometimes we just can't move the mark forward. I love this quote by Louis Giglio, because you know, in and of yourself, if you try to do it like Joshua, you can't. When Joshua relied on God, he gave him the victory. And when we rely on God, he'll give it to you as well. Louis Giglio says this: if some form of bondage is in our life, if some attitude seemingly can't be shaken, if some character flaw apparently can't be overcome, if some thought darkens our mind, if some problem has sunk its teeth into our life and we can't shake it as we move through our day, then take heart, because none of these giants are a match for Jesus. All of these giants can and will fall. We can be encouraged that there is room for us to acknowledge our own weakness and even to prepare to persevere and try again when we face our own problems, even while remaining confident in God's power. Because of Jesus' victory on the cross, we remain confident in our faith, even in spite of our own weakness. The effects of sin that might seem like giants to us can take on different forms, but Jesus is the solution for each and every one, and will bring victory, whether it's in this life or the life to come. Jesus defeated our greatest enemies, sin, death, and the devil, with his sacrificial death and resurrection. The biggest problem that we'll ever have was nullified by Christ on the cross. I'm gonna take a short reprieve. My friend, if you've never heard that truth, a lot of this message was focused towards Christians in the room today. But I want to take a break from the message. I want to focus on you that came to church just searching. Maybe you came to church because a spouse drug you. A friend's been inviting you for years. Maybe you saw a giant conqueror take place in somebody's life that you love, and you want access to that giant conqueror as well. I want to share with you right now how you can have access to the giant killer. His name is Jesus. Every Christian in this room under my voice has done this at some point in their life, and today, I trust, is your day. The way you have access to this giant conqueror is this. Number one, you need to admit that you're not perfect. The Bible calls those imperfections sin. You see, sin separates us from God, but God loved you so much that he sent his son, Jesus, to die on the cross for your sins and to rise again the third day so that you could have a relationship with him. So we acknowledge that we're not perfect. We believe that Jesus died on the cross for those imperfections, and we call on him to be our Savior. We do that through prayer. And I'd encourage you to do that today. So on everybody in the room, heads bowed, eyes closed. Christians in the room, I want you to pray that the Holy Spirit begins to move in the hearts of those who have not started their relationship with the giant conqueror. But if you've yet to follow Jesus yet, this is what I want you to do. It's with belief that we come into a relationship with God. And we call on him through this prayer. God, I admit that I'm a sinner. I believe that your son died on the cross for my sins. And I'm calling on him to be my Savior. Lord, help me to live my life for you today. I love you. Amen. For those of you who made this decision today, I want you to take the card that you got on your way in. I want you to mark at the very bottom, I've decided to receive Jesus. Put your name on there. Let me help you start your relationship with the giant conqueror. You need healing? Check that box. You want to be delivered? Check that box. We want to help you start your relationship today. For those of you who have already started that relationship, you've started your journey with Jesus maybe a while now, and maybe you're like Achan. Maybe you're like David. Maybe you're like Paul, Peter. Maybe you're like anybody but Jesus. You've walked with Christ, but there's been times and moments of sin in your life. The Apostle Paul, probably the greatest Christian in the church era, says this in one of his books. He says, the things that I do, I don't want to do, and the things I don't want to do, I do. Maybe you felt like that today. And you know, I love this quote. One of my favorite preachers of old, Spurgeon, said, by perseverance, the snail reached the ark. I want you to think about this analogy, okay? Think about the highs and the lows of the snail's journey. He views the ark from far away. He can see it. He can see it. Unsure if he can make it in time, the snail moves as fast as he can, and he watches all the other animals racing past him. And nobody seems aware of his inability to move fast enough. Noah, however, picks up the snail and promises him he will make it on time before the ark door shuts. While doubting his own ability, the snail trusts in the ability of his provider to take him where he needs to go. We too have someone who provides for us, someone who carries us where we need to go. In a moment, the band's gonna come and we're gonna sing a song about blessing, about victory. And maybe there's something in your life that you need to get right. The chapel will be open. We're gonna worship and reflect on what all God has done and all God's willing to do. But Christian, today, if you stand like Achan under the umbrella blocker, under the blessing blocker, persevere. Take the sin blocker. Persevere and continue to move forward. Remember, make it right. Move forward in Christ and move forward to victory. Remove this blessing blocker and close it. Close it down and throw it away, because the enemy doesn't want you to throw away the blessing blocker. The enemy wants you to stay under the umbrella of the blessing blocker. But God, in his son Jesus, gave you the victory. So throw away the blessing blocker and live your life to him. Claim that victory and claim that blessing.